So we are going to stay on the government investigations theme, but we're now going to move over to talk a little bit about non-merger conduct and government investigations in the non-merger context. We're going to be exploring issues related to excessive pricing by itself as a potential competition law theory or a trigger for competition law concerns, various types of what goes under the rubric generally of life cycle management, as well as rebating and discounting in the circumstances in which they can potentially be challenged or looked into as exclusionary strategies. The idea, we're going to try to have a dialogue. We are going to try to get the U.S. and the European perspective and to keep all of the lawyers honest, the perspective from the economists as well. And joining me on the panel, I have my partner as my kind of co-moderator, Mélanie Thill Tayara from our Paris office, who's also head of our life science group. And immediately on my right, I have Gail Levine, who is a deputy director of the FTC's Bureau of Competition with responsibility, among many other things, for healthcare and life science sector. And then next to Gail is Raphaël de Coninck, who is from Charles River Associates, who is an economist who, in addition to spending time at the EU as an economist, has been working with companies and clients in investigations and other matters, merger and non-merger, for many, many years. And then we've heard from Paul Csiszár already, but I will note that Paul has a distinction, I think, of being the only member of the panel that has two law degrees, one from Hungary and one from the United States. and his practice.
Tops me.
Yes, it certainly tops me. Paul's going to now switch gears and give us some of his views on a non-merger enforcement in Europe. So we're going to start with excessive pricing, which is an area where there may be some different perspectives between the U.S. and Europe. And Mélanie, you're going to kick us off.
Thank you, George. Is this working? Yes.
Now it's working. Okay. So the issue of excessive pricing as an infringement under antitrust laws is a pretty old concept, but until very recently was in fact very rarely applied in the European Union. It's an old type of abuse because in fact since the adoption of the EU treaties, we have the possibility that excessive pricing could be an infringement under EU rules, provided that the pricing is incompatible with the internal market and if it may affect trade between member states. However, except in a case called United Brands, to which Paul will speak, which was absolutely not in the pharma area but concerned bananas, the excessive pricing prohibition has rarely been applied. But since 2016, especially, we have seen an increase of investigations concerning excessive pricing. And I have put on the slide the investigations which are either ongoing. Well, in fact, they are all ongoing because even those which have already seen a decision by the relevant National Competition Authority, these cases are still under review on appeal. So I would like to focus maybe on two cases which are possibly pretty emblematic concerning excessive pricing. The first case I would like to say two words on is the Aspen case in Italy. And the reason why I'm talking about it is that Aspen has been faced with investigations in other member states, which has conducted, I think, if I'm not wrong, the European Commission to to take the case on, probably in order to avoid that there will be contradictory decisions in the different member states. So in Aspen, the issue at stake was that Aspen acquired in 2009 the marketing rights of several cancer treatments from GSK and entered, following this acquisition, into negotiation with the Italian Medicine Agency. Aspen threatened to withdraw these medicines from the Italian market if the Italian Medicine Agency did not agree to a price increase. And although these products were pretty mature, there was no therapeutic alternative to these very efficient medicines. And so there was no choice for the Italian Medicine Agency than to accept the price increase, which increased from 300 to 1,500%. This case is under appeal before the Italian Competition Authority. The other case I would like to say a few words on, but maybe Raphaël can tell us more about it, is the Pfizer-Flynn case, where in the UK, Pfizer transferred the UK distribution rights of its epanutin capsules to the generic company called Flynn Pharma. And at the time, regulatory rules in the UK allowed that when a product was debranded, the regulated price did not apply anymore. So the product continued to be manufactured by Pfizer, sold at a higher price to Flynn Pharma, and then Flynn Pharma was marketing it with the effect that the price came to the patients with an increased price of more than 2,000%. So the CMA did not agree and considered this was excessive pricing. The case is now, I think, under review. There are a lot of procedural difficulties, which I will not elaborate on. But my question to Paul before giving him the floor is, in fact, you see that in those two cases I was mentioning, there was a sort of behavior which was accompanying the price increase, and then it was challenged under the excessive pricing theory of harm. And my question to Paul is, would that assessment about high prices be the same, and I'm speaking about mature products, not about innovative products, the same if it's not accompanied by a behavior which is at first sight a little bit of shocking?
Mélanie learned from the previous speaker, because I never had a chance to answer the previous question, which I've got. So now I'm on the spot. Usually purely abusive conduct, such as high prices, it's very difficult to do a case. And I think all competition authorities are inclined to look for some mischievous conduct, some foreclosure conduct, particularly because we tend to believe that the invisible hand works in our market economy. So if there is no additional foreclosure conduct or pulling a fast on regulatory agencies, lying to the patent office or withdrawing marketing authorization, which used to be an opportunity for fighting generics in Europe, it's a famous AstraZeneca case in Europe. So you always tend to look because you believe in the invisible hand. Now, you will see on my slides, which is getting there. So this is a different slide, but in two slides, I will be there, and I make the claim that the invisible hand in this sector on both sides of the Atlantic sometimes got stuck in the pocket, because the invisible hand doesn't take care of what's supposed to take care. Look at this guy. You look familiar? You're Americans, right?
Right.
A life-saving drug, patent expired 1961. The drug has been sold between $3 to $12 in the last, 50 years. The gentleman in 2015, through his Turing pharmaceutical company, jacked up the price for 750, and I think he gave an interview on CB, wherever. It said, hey, shareholders value, look, if you want to live, you better pay. Now, I wouldn't stop there. Does anybody know what's today the price of Doraprim, of his drug, which he raised the price to 750 in 2015? Please raise your hands. Anybody? Okay. Can you Google it for me and come back to me in a few minutes? Please. When I was at NYU 6 months ago, a professor yelled in, Paul is right. It's still 750, 3 years later. So I'm jumping a little bit further. Because I think there is a market failure and a regulatory failure in this field. There is no other explanation. It's a drug, Doraprim, which is sold in 80 countries between 30 cents and 90 cents. It is no arbitrage going on. Obviously, this is a combination of a market and regulatory failure. Much more learned colleagues, economists should address this from another point of view. Competition authorities stuck with this problem, and what do you do? So hence the answer, when you just see high prices, you really don't want to interfere or intervene, to be more both. But the problem remains. And I'm sorry, I went in a crazy way because of this question. I want to go back. Shall I do my presentation now?
Okay.
So basically, I want to make, first of all, a distinction between proprietary innovative drugs, which is the hepatitis C's, Gilead, Sovaldi, similar things, and their high prices, which is in themselves a problem for society, how to pay for these innovative drugs. But that's a totally different problem, in my view, and require totally different solutions on both sides of the Atlantic, or in all developed OECD countries, how to make it more affordable for society, and how to pay for innovative drugs, and how not to stifle the incentive to innovate, which is probably the most important thing from a dynamic perspective. From this guy, and there are many other guys, I forgot his name, it's somewhere in Europe, it's a similar small company, it's just taking the abuse again and again. You have similar events in the US. There's a quote from Forbes 2017. Last time I checked, Forbes is not a lefty Bernie Sanders type of paper. And it says it happened again. Of course, it happens again. A drug company has brought a drug that has been available in generic elsewhere in the world, decades, shockingly inflated prices. So clearly, this is not a competition problem. So what do you do in Europe? Luckily or on, so this is basically what you see in the life cycle. It's an abnormal price hike after a long tail of a drug which is supposed to be replaced by probably better or more efficient drugs. What do you do? Obviously, it's a political social question, and if nobody acts, somebody else will do some more radical things. We see, I mean, you know it much better in the United States. States start to pass legislation aimed at generics because somehow you want to deal with this, whether you call it price gouging or whatever, doesn't really matter. It's a problem. And we know that it shouldn't be there. The invisible hand shouldn't remain stuck in the pocket because we believe in market economy. So a lot of public attention and solutions. Here is a little explanation, in my view, why not patent protected drugs can reach these high prices is because of the unbelievable inelasticity. I mean, Shaquille's drug, if you want to live, you have to buy it. So unless you get on the plane, you go to Mexico or I don't know where, and you buy the drug, you have to buy it. If you have a contractual relationship with your insurance company, they have to buy it for you, et cetera, et cetera. So what's happening in Europe? First, before we go to what's happening in Europe, So you get into this philosophical debate with antitrust scholars, practitioners, and enforcers. Should we or shouldn't we do it? If you intervene, what's the remedy? What's the right price? Do we want to be a price regulator? Extremely complex, pain in the neck problem. That's why we're doing only one case and not half a dozen, because we don't want to be price regulators. And I think a lot of drugs can be claimed as too expensive. So what do you do with that? But in Europe, as it was mentioned, the legislator itself called unfair prices as potential abuse. So that leaves, and you saw this text from Melanie's slide as well. This is the rough equivalent. Article 102 is your Sherman Act Section 2 unilateral conduct provision, that if you're dominant, which means you have a huge market power, big market power, how we define dominance, it's a difficult issue, but assume you have dominance, and then you cannot abuse your dominant position, and one abuse could be imposing unfair prices. Stop. So the legislator gives this problem to us, the agency, and whether to intervene or not, it's not what our colleagues in the U.S. ask, whether we should at all intervene. For us, the question is when, because the legislator said you must intervene when you see an unfair price. So for us to calibrate when, under what circumstances something is unfair is very difficult. We've been ducking this issue for many, many years. That's why, as Melanie said, for decades, there were very few cases here. But giving this Shrekili phenomenon, you had to deal with it. And the letters which the MEPs were sending, they were coming half a dozen a week. Why don't you do something about it? Read the text. Every law student can read the text. Don't you think Shrekili's price is unfair? And I use Shrekili because he never came to Europe, so I don't accuse Aspen or anybody in pending cases. It's very easy to. I'm grateful to that guy that helps me to make my points. So there's another point. Critics say, wouldn't regulatory solutions be better? Of course. So therefore, you shouldn't use antitrust. For that, I always say, look, if you wake up in the middle of the night, you see your neighbor's house is on fire, you run out, you ask the neighbor, have you called the firefighters? Yes, they are on their way. Okay, what do you do? You don't go back and sleep. You still get a bucket and you start to help the neighbor a little bit to take the fire out. I see antitrust is something like on the margins, try to send a message to legislators, regulators, that deal with this market failure, deal with this regulatory failure. Shouldn't be that anybody succeeded. How much Doraprim, Shkreli's drug, is? Have you Googled it? It cannot be that 3 years later, it's still 750 when it's an off-patent drug. It shouldn't be. So somehow you need a more structural solution. In the meantime, in Europe, you have Article 102, so you have to do something. But we are not very eager to do a lot of things. National competition authorities, who, like states in the United States, who do pay from their own taxpayers' money for the little Shkreli's situations, are much more eager to intervene, because they get, rightfully so, the stakeholders' pressure from the treasury, from their respective treasury. This is United Bread. It's an old case. If you read the language, it doesn't help too much. It was written by lawyers 30 years ago. It's circular. It's conclusionary. It's all these things which not too helpful. Economists have a field trip, or will have in a minute, a field trip on destroying all these notions. Again, back to the point that the legislator did say, when you see an unfair price, you should act if it's a dominant player. When I'm really pushed in the corner, and I'm says, how do you tell? I use, last night we got it, Justice
Stewart's
famous quote, I know it when I see it. You know, it was in a different context, but yes. when I see Mr. Shkreli's 750 drug, I know it when I see it. Had he come to Europe, he would have gotten the red carpet treatment from us. Okay. So takeaways. I don't remember what
I
wrote.
It was mine, in fact. But good. Maybe we can do
good.
Our friends do not have slides.
So yeah. I think we've heard from Paul that Paul has a tool, maybe a burden from the legislators to on excessive pricing. In the U.S., I guess Gail, two questions for you. Number one. Do we have a tool? And number two, you know, what's your view on kind of excessive pricing as excessive pricing, you know, unmoored from other conduct as an antitrust violation?
Sure. So first things first, I have to make the same disclaimer that my colleagues in other government agencies have had to do. I'm delighted to be here today, but I speak only for myself, not for the Federal Trade Commission or any individual commissioner. Under the Federal Trade Commission's Act, under Section 5 of our Act, we can challenge unfair or deceptive acts or practices, colloquially known as UDAP, and we can bring cases as unfair methods of competition. We've been pretty clear, and we said so explicitly this summer, the agency said this summer, that although the FTC hasn't ruled out the possibility that in certain extreme circumstances, an excessive price increase on a pharmaceutical product could constitute a UDAP, an unfair or deceptive act or practice, you know, to date, we haven't challenged something like that. We haven't brought that case. So although it'd be interesting and engaging to hash out these issues, I think this audience is very practically minded and practically oriented, so I want to instead spend time a little bit now and then going forward later in this panel talking about the kinds of cases we have brought where high drug prices are driven by anti-competitive practices. The FTC doesn't hesitate to engage and challenge on competition grounds. So examples that we'll be talking about, I think, later in this panel include things like reverse payments, where we made new law in the area, product hopping, where we brought our first product hopping case this year, citizens' petitions, abuse of citizens' petitions at the FDA. Cases like that is where the FTC has engaged on these kinds of issues.
So, Raphaël, anything to add from the economist perspective?
Question is, you know, why intervene in case of excessive pricing? In principle, when you see high prices, that's when you expect to have entry in a market. So the high prices, you know, usually act as a signal that is valuable in the economy to other participants to enter a market. So that's the default. That's what you normally expect. Now, it can be that in very specific instances and under very narrow conditions, you don't observe that. But what's very important is to have clear limiting principles about when to potentially intervene. So in terms of the high, you know, the high level comments, first, what's really essential to consider before going into an excessive price case is what are the barriers to entry? What is it? Why is it that you would expect the price increase, you know, not to be transitory, but actually to last? So in the pharma context, you wonder, well, why is it that you will not have generic entry? And it can very well be that for some, you know, very small markets, the market is just not big enough to have generic entry. So that can be a condition, but it's very specific. Now, in terms of principle, I think what's also important is that you make sure that the intervention does not in any way impede innovation. So if the dominant position is a result of innovation, that is should be rewarded in a way by allowing the dominant company to price at a higher level than at a competitive, a purely competitive level. And then the third limiting principle is really that there is no regulatory solution to the excessive pricing that is observed. Because if there is one, this is obviously a better and more natural intervention than coming through antitrust. Now, question is, what is an excessive pricing? So we haven't really gone too very, very far in the question. Of course, Paul knows what it is, but for the pharmaceutical company, it's also good for them to know it. So what has the CMA done, so the UK Competition Authority done in the Flynn-Pfizer case? So as a disclaimer there, I was the expert witness for Flynn Pharma. Well, in its original case, the Competition Authority, the United Kingdom, tried to apply this United Brand test that was presented before. And so what it did is considered, the return on sales that the company makes on selling the drug. And the test that it implied was just saying, well, if your return on sales is more than 6%, so that's too much. That's the first leg of the United Brands test. And then it said, okay, we should still see whether it's justified or not, because maybe it's more than 6%, but it can be justified. But in that case, it decided it is not. So obviously the court, Competition Appeal Tribunal, gave a very hard time to the CMA on that, because that's not the right way to determine what is an excessive price. Actually, it's very difficult to determine what's an excessive price, but the guidance that we got from the court, which remanded the case and sent it back to the CMA, is to look at benchmarks, right? Is there something really exceptional that you see in the price of that drug when you compare it to other drugs that are in a similar position? And actually what I showed there in my testimony in the tribunal is that if you apply this 6% test to all the other products, they would nearly all of them be at excessive pricing. So this is a very poor test that they applied. There's also an even more fundamental question, which is, well, dominance in itself is not something that is unlawful. So if you allow to have companies that are dominant, if that has to have any sense, it must be that they are not required to price exactly in the same way as a perfectly competitive company would do. So then that also has implications for what benchmark you use to determine whether the price is excessive. If you compare, the price of a dominant company to perfectly competitive benchmarks, then this is not a good way to determine whether, there's really something exceptional in the pricing of a dominant company. So in conclusion on these points, excessive prices, if they are used at all, should be really, really limited to the most extreme cases, with a good explanation about why, the market does not self-correct in this context. And there is one last point, which is actually that there is potentially a link with the approach that some authorities like the Commission has taken in other fields, which is standard essential patents, where it has applied excessive pricing. And in that context, the excessive pricing is linked with a declaration of a licensee holder to license its technology at friend terms, right? And then if it prices much too high afterwards, then you can come and say, oh, you make commitment, you somehow locked in the market in using this particular technology, and then you increase prices. So there's a combination of the excessive pricing with some other elements, some other conduct. And in pharma, one potential conduct that you can also think about is whether customers are locked in some drugs, right? And that goes to the question about why does the market does not self-correct? Well, there are some instances, some drugs for which you may have a narrow therapeutic index, limited
possibility for a patient to switch to another drug. And so that has to be taken into account into why potentially generic entry could be difficult for a particular product. But it's extremely case specific, and you need good reasons about why the market would not self-correct in such instances.
So one takeaway point, I think, even for a U.S. audience and for pharma companies in the U.S., although, as Gail mentioned, there really hasn't been any enforcement activity with respect to challenges of excessive pricing as excessive pricing. If you're thinking about a large and unprecedented change in your pricing, you can expect that it's going to attract attention. It's going to attract attention from customers, perhaps others who may want to see some action taken on it. And so one thing you need to think about is the question that kind of Raphaël left us with is, why is it we're able to do this? And why is it that the market won't self-correct? And make sure, and you know, this is why kind of the right hand has to know what the left hand's doing, that there's not something happening somewhere, some strategies being pursued that might be subject to inquiry, because you can expect it's like a signal flare going up, right? And there are any number of cases that have been where conduct investigations have been accompanied by, maybe even preceded by, large and unprecedented changes in price. So switching gears to talk about some of that conduct now that it might be connected to. We're gonna kind of address some conduct that is often referred to in the industry under the kind of rubric lifecycle management. And lifecycle management is not by itself an inherently nefarious activity. It can refer to perfectly lawful and legitimate ways of improving, increasing the value of a drug product. But there are some strategies that have come under scrutiny and have been challenged as being exclusionary as opposed to competition on the merits. So Gail, turning to you first, one of the areas has been what's called product hopping, which I like to refer to as sequential innovation, but nobody has taken that term up. So if any of the press here today want to use sequential innovation, I'd like to get that term out there. But generally under antitrust law, innovation is a good thing. New products are a good thing. When are they not, potentially?
Yeah, that's a great question. Right, and I think that actually raises the exact right place to start here. You know, introducing new or reformulated products, can be a very good thing if you've got a more efficacious or safer product to introduce to the market. You know, broadly speaking, there's hardly anything wrong with that. That can be very good for consumers. But product hopping, if your term doesn't catch on, can be, anti-competitive. And we brought our first, the Federal Trade Commission, brought our first product hopping case this year, this summer. We settled with the company on very favorable terms and won tens of millions of dollars to redistribute back to the parties who were injured, who were overcharged. So the basic facts look like this. The company involved was called Reckitt Benckiser. They sold Suboxone. Suboxone, as you probably know better than anyone, is a drug that treats opioid addiction. So Reckitt sold Suboxone as a tablet, and with generic competition for that tablet form coming on the horizon, Reckitt introduced a film version of the product, right? Under state law, the film version wasn't going to be substitutable with the generic tablets. So Reckitt, seeing this generic competition on the horizon, pushed the market toward the film, away from the tablet, in a number of ways. This is all according to our publicly filed complaint. The company said that the film was safer than the tablets, but without any data to back it up. It significantly raised the tablet's price, even though the film was more expensive to make and according to Reckitt, better. But anyway, it made the tablet more expensive than the film, and ultimately it discontinued the tablet form. The cumulative effect of these moves is that by the time generic tablets came on the market, 85% of Suboxone prescriptions were for the film, not for the tablets. In effect, that meant that Reckitt never really had to compete on the merits for the tablet form with the lower cost generics in the market. That's what brought us to challenge that kind of conduct in this case, and we reached a consent order with them in addition to the money that, to the tens of millions of dollars that reflected what we said in our press release was the egregiousness of the conduct at issue.
So, Gail, let me ask you a question about that in particular. From an antitrust perspective, the generic tablet could still compete with the film. It was allowed to enter the market.
That's right.
So why is it, why is that not enough to preserve competition, that the tablet could compete with the film, even though the branded form of the tablet is off the market?
Yeah, well, and it has to do with sort of the realities of the market. And this goes to a larger point about this case, but also all of our cases. We take our facts as we find them, right? The markets should perhaps work this way or that way, but, you know, we take our facts as we find them. It's an intensely fact-driven inquiry at the FTC, and I'm sure that's true with my sister agencies here. But the fact of the matter was that when, by the time the generics were able to enter the market, prescribers were, had their eye on film. They were not prescribing for the tablets. And because of that, the generic product couldn't get any purchase. And, you know, we care about competition, not about competitors. We care about consumers, not about market players necessarily. So I should add that the important effect here was that consumers, patients, their insurance, their insurers, their, and via that their premiums, were going to be affected. You would not get the benefit of generic entry and its price disciplining effects because of the conduct that Reckitt did here by hopping the product to the film.
And if I'm not mistaken, the Reckitt case also involved some allegations, at least with respect to regulatory misconduct in terms of the reasoning for the claim of that the film was more safer. And I know that's played an issue in some other cases that the commission has brought in terms of allegedly sham citizen petitions and the like. Maybe you could speak to that as an alleged area of exclusionary conduct.
Yeah, sure. So, yes, and you know, we brought a citizen's petition case that, to your point, also explored abuse of government process in this way. So, you know, any citizen can file a petition called, not unsurprisingly, a citizen's petition at the federal, the FDA, to challenge or question FDA action. And when if pharmaceutical companies, you know, file these citizen's petitions with an eye toward delaying the approval of a generic or biosimilar application without, and this is what you were, I think, alluding to earlier, without valid scientific issues that would justify the objection, it can really hurt competition and it can hurt consumers, it can hurt patients by delaying entry. We brought a case just on facts like that. We sued a company called Shire Viropharma, alleging, among other things, just that kind of abusive citizens petition process. I'm getting the 5-minute flag from over here, so I will not get into the merits of the case too much, but I'll just let you know that the case went up to the Third Circuit. What? Yeah?
Just keep going.
Okay. All right. I'm blowing through my time. All right. The main thing was, look, Shire, according to our complaint, saw again on the horizon a threat to its monopoly position with respect to a drug that it had. It saw generic competition entering, and so it submitted to the FDA over the course of a number of years, 43 filings and 3 federal court proceedings, with the FDA, all allegedly to delay approval of that generic companies, that of that generic application, to where they could maintain their monopoly in this very lucrative drug. In the end, according to our allegations, the FDA rejected the citizens' petition and concluded that the citizens' petitions were based on their scientific challenges that were the foundation of those citizens' petitions, lacked merit, were unsupported. Generic companies finally entered, and on that day, when the FDA approved the three ANDAs for the generic version of the branded capsule, Shire lost almost 70% of its unit sales within 3 months, all according to our allegations. The case went up to the Third Circuit, and it's important to note that the Third Circuit ruled against us on a jurisdictional issue. But that jurisdictional has more to do with the timing of our lawsuits and the strength of our of the Federal Trade Commission Act than it has to do with the merits of this case, you know, the merits of this challenge to the abuse of citizens' petitions.
So one more question on the U.S. front, and then we'll jump across the pond, as they say. I don't want to spend too much time on patent settlement agreements because that's been the subject of a lot of panels that a lot of people have sat through. But one question about the new California legislation that was recently passed, and whether you think that changes the landscape. Now, the new California legislation, just for the audience, changes the standard for assessing. It basically creates a presumption of illegality if there's some payment in a settlement agreement from a brand company to a generic, something of value. And it also tightens up some of the requirements for potential exceptions might be too strong a word, but potential carve-outs for things like saved litigation cost savings and the like. It's interesting because it's coming from a state, it's coming from a single state, and it kind of changes the standard somewhat. So I don't know if you have a view on whether it changes the landscape.
Well, you know, I sort of think that any additional tool to challenge anti-competitive reverse payments is something that we need to be taking a very, very close look at. Look, if it's used to challenge anti-competitive conduct and reverse payments, that could be a great benefit to consumers. Look, but I know the devil's in the details, of that bill, the devil's in the details of its implementation, its enforcement, and its interpretation in the courts. So I look forward to seeing how it plays out on the ground. I will just now just add, though, by the way, that this year, the year we settled the activist litigation, the reverse payment case that went to the Supreme Court, we settled that case on remand this year. And notably, this is the 10th anniversary of the filing of the activist case, the case that made new law in and allowed us to challenge anti-competitive reverse payments.
Yes, turning to Europe, we have only seen very few cases in the European Union with respect to the issue of product hopping. So the most important case Paul will talk to is AstraZeneca, which has put a lot of attention to the behavior of AstraZeneca. And we have had a case in the UK, which also concerned Gail Brackett Benckiser. But just a few words to that subject matter. The situation was a little bit different to the Suboxone case, because what Brackett Benckiser did in that case was, and that there was also a regulatory issue. In fact, in the UK, if the product is not listed in the list for prescription by general practitioner, they cannot prescribe a product. And so what Reckitt Benckiser did is they delisted the Gaviscon classical product from the list of prescription just before the arrival of their new Gaviscon. It was called Gaviscon Advanced. And so when the practitioners prescribed the medicine, they only could prescribe the non-generic version of the new product, in fact. And so that was sanctioned by the UFT at the time. And I think I see a big difference with the Suboxone case, because in this case, the generic could not penetrate the market because it was impossible for them to be prescribed by the doctors. In the case, in the Suboxone case, I mean, you in fact protected to some extent the weak competitor, who are the generics, because they could have faced the competition by Reckitt Benckiser just in investing to make their product known by the market and not just benefit from the substitution, the automatic substitution. So I have some reservations about the Suboxone case, because I think it's a little bit about protecting competitors and not protecting customers or consumers. But that being said, I will not spend more time on this. So I would like Paul to tell us under which circumstances the Commission considers that a second generation product or drug is not a genuine improvement, but merely means extending the protection of a patent or of the data. And in fact, or the regulatory exclusivity, sorry, to be precise, and not about and about delaying a generic or biosimilar entry on the market. And I would also like you to address the question that if a pharma company introduces a new formulation to the benefit of the patients, be it, for example, because the treatment duration is reduced, or for the comfort of the patient, for example, switching from IV to tablets, which is much more comfortable than spending hours in the hospital to get IV, could this be regarded as an anti-competitive improvement? And what are the criteria you would take into account to consider that this is anti-competitive? Is the timing a subject matter? Is the availability of the improvement, which has maybe not been put on the market immediately when it was available, but waiting for the moment where competition would arrive? How would the Commission view this sort of situation?
You should know we have not coordinated these questions particularly, so I feel totally free to give the perfect cop-out answer to this question, saying it depends on the specific facts of each case. And let me start with a few high-level comments. My personal experience, my colleagues' experience in the department where we work, life cycle management is the goal of the pharmaceutical companies. And there's nothing wrong with that. In all industries, you do that. Again, you can make an argument that there are finite resources in society. Does it really make sense to kind of delist the cheaper ones, maybe private patients, private insurers, or public purse? Should say that, yes, I have to take the pill not for 10 days, but 20 days, or not only once, but three times a day. And if it's a fraction of the price, maybe somebody gets better medical treatment somewhere else because the total health budget is finite. I don't want to go there. All I'm observing is that there are many ways to skin a cat, and there must be different forums where life cycle management is taught to pharmaceutical executives. Why I think that? Because in our sector inquiry 10 years ago, we found that about 90% of all these incremental innovations are introduced in a very narrow time frame, about 24 to 18, 16 months before the patent cliff. Surprise, surprise. It just comes right there. So obviously the economic business interest is compelling to come out with a toolbox right before the patent cliff. And the toolbox has some of the good innovations in it, has pay for delay, has acquisition of active ingredient producers, et cetera, whichever works. You need a shotgun approach when these generics are coming, one way or the other, because it's vital that the patent cliff, the de facto patent cliff, is postponed. So we know the game. I think AstraZeneca is a wonderful case, and I did find a very good connection to an older U.S. Supreme Court case. I don't know whether it's out of favor or not. It's the Aspen Ski case, 1984. I don't know whether it's fashionable to mention or not. Some cases yes, some cases don't. Because in AstraZeneca, again, what was the toolbox? At that time, I mean, there was a very crude conduct by AstraZeneca. It's basically lying to the patent office, providing misleading information, not lying, to the patent office to get the additional supplemental certificate to get an extra, I don't know, exactly, letter of exclusivity. So that's the simplest way. If you can manipulate the regulator who stamps your legal monopoly, thank you very much. I don't have to deal with other things. In addition to that, AstraZeneca withdrew the marketing authorization of the older product. And at that time, that prevented the generics to rely on the scientific data for their generic marketing authorizations. Since then, the legislator in Europe filled the gap in, and even though you withdraw your marketing authorization as a private company, the benefits of that marketing authorization are there and running in favor of the generics. So you see these attempts, the toolboxes, to stifle or delay a generic entry. Again, for very good or not so good, but for business reasons. The Supreme Court, the ECJ, the highest court in Europe, basically said there are many ways to skin a cat. For example, these two objectionable elements. And we don't think this comes under competition on the merits. This is the woolly phrase the court used. And I did find the same expression in Aspen Skiing in 1984, where the Supreme Court said that the conduct of the company didn't come under competition on the merits. And the U.S. Supreme Court even went further, that there was a foreclosure effect there. And one should ask, is this the least intrusive way to achieve the alleged legitimate objectives of the company at stake? So nothing wrong with introducing an incremental improvement. It's nothing wrong with gaining market power or pricing power or more patients, more customers, if you did something valid. Then the question is, if this has an effect clearly to stifle generic entry, was this the least intrusive or not? I think that is the best way to grasp it. AstraZeneca clearly says that the dominant company has the right to fend off generic entry. So we should look for some extra conduct, which is an extra step in addition to the pure innovation. Now, whether timing is enough, playing with the timing or playing with rebates, which we may discuss later, which relates to the older or the newer product. I mean, all these things get really very fact specific. So it would be very, very difficult to draw a conclusion. Clearly, the incentive is there to slow generic entry. Somewhere you have to draw the line. You look at the toolbox, what the company used. Could that innovation have been introduced and legitimately gain more market power, more pricing, more business by the originator without the additional conduct which stifled further generic entry? I think somewhere there the right question is.
Raphaël, anything to add from the economist perspective?
Yeah, just a few comments. And George, you were talking about sequential innovation as a different term. I think economists call this incremental innovation and something as something positive. Definitely, and certainly in pharma, breakthrough innovation is important, but also incremental innovation. So the concerns from a competition law point of view are quite clear, and I think here we are in a world of exclusionary conduct. So, you know, intervention is easier to understand potentially than what we were discussing at the beginning of the panel on excessive prices. At least it's clear cut when you're talking about exclusionary conduct here of the generic. Of course, there is again, important regulatory aspect to it, but it's also definitely a competition issue. So Paul was talking about and Mélanie, the specific, you know, criteria that you need to take into account in addition to this incremental innovation, and of course, mentioned timing. I think more generally, what's really important is to see and to look at the actions that are taken to ensure the migration from the old product to the new product. And there you can have, you know, the extreme case of the delisting of the old product, but you can achieve the same result potentially with leaving the old product, but playing with how you market the new product with respect to the old one, or how, you know, you set your relative prices of the new versus the old product. So once you see that there is this migration to the new product, this is an element that can really limit the scope for the generics to compete for the old products, either due to the way the generics are prescribed, or if patients get somehow locked in into the new drug, or would not really switch back to the old product. So a key question there is, you know, what's your test for intervention? Of course, you know, in an ideal world, you would do, you know, a full balancing test, looking at the benefits of innovation and the harm to competition due to the exclusion of the generic competition that benefits consumers. Of course, this is extremely difficult to do, especially for competition authority to really, you know, measure and balance this properly. So alternative tests have been proposed. A conservative one is the no economic sense test, which is, you know, does the originator introduce this incremental innovation in order to fence off the generic competition? So would it make sense for the innovator to do it if not for achieving the exclusion of the generic competition? Last point is this should not be looked at, you know, in isolation. We're talking about an exclusionary conduct of generic competition. So this is, you know, product hopping is one aspect of it, but what you often see is that if the goal of a specific company is to exclude the generic competition, it can very well use product hopping in combination with additional conduct. And that can bring a lot of light on how to interpret this product hopping. I'm thinking, for example, about, you know, disparagement of the generic, or communication on that may be misleading about the equivalence of the generic, which are things that we see, or very, very aggressive IP litigation to get the generic out of the market. So those should be taken into account into the wider economic context to assess the conduct.
Right. Thanks, Raphaël. Well, we don't have to compete between sequential and incremental innovation. How about we go with incremental innovation and we'll split the royalties? We allowed to do that? Why don't we open up for questions now? Any questions from the audience? Yeah, Valerie.
Okay. In fairness, I should let you know I'm a reporter with Bloomberg Law. I had a question for Gail, and I don't know if this is allowed, but I'd love to hear from Amy McFarlane as well. I'm curious, with the oversight there is in the U.S., the enforcement actions, how much of a deterrent is it? I mean, the new California law, it says here, can make it easier for the AG to pursue civil penalties up to $20 million. That's not even a rounding error for a lot of these large companies. I'm wondering, how effective are the dollar amounts in the big picture?
Right. So going back to the California law point, I think as we were talking about before, the devil's in the details. Let's see how it's implemented. Let's see how it's enforced. Let's see how the courts handle it. We at the Federal Trade Commission are very mindful about bringing cases that match the facts. And we are doggedly rigorous when it comes to that. We have to appreciate the signals that the case sends to the individual, defendant in the case, the parties in the case. And we also think hard about what the case means for the larger market. So Amy, do you want to build on that in some way?
I would just say, I'm just going to note that there is a lot of discussion lately about penalty amounts and what the different effect is. And I think that's really good that there's a lot of public discourse about that right now. And it's made me very happy that yourself and others in the media are really sort of bringing that to the forefront. So, yeah.
Just one thing I'll note on that question is it's interesting. If you look back over time, the initial cases that the FTC brought back in like the early 2000s, which ended in consents with no monetary penalties, actually had, when you look at the data, a dramatic effect. It wasn't until the appellate courts got involved and kind of loosened or changed the test a little bit that kind of opened up the field that you started to see the reverse payment cells go back up. And of course, after activists, it's changed again. So there are a lot of other things, just from a counseling perspective, I can tell you, other than just the threat of actually monetary penalties that go into that judgment.
Yeah, and to that point, I'm sort of proud to note that since activists, the number of settlements potentially involving reverse payments has decreased significantly, which isn't to say that the number of settlements has decreased. The number of settlements, I think, has actually increased, but the number of potentially anti-competitive reverse payment settlements has decreased across the board, which is a sort of a testament to the kind of effect these cases can have, even outside the individual action that you bring.
Could I jump? Just one word. We observed in the last 5-8 years since the first decision of the Supreme Court activists that the total number of settlements in Europe slightly went up and the potentially problematic ones went down. So it's the same thing.
If you look at the private cases being filed, even there have been private cases filed very recently over it, but they all involve old settlements. They all involve pre-activist settlements. So any other questions from the audience? Okay, why don't we take a quick break? Let's really try to keep it to 5 minutes this time, and we'll come back with our private litigation.